blessed and reassured.
Wonderful in me. God is doing something wonderful in me. It's something awesome and incredible that only He will get the glory. God is doing something wonderful, incredible and awesome. God is doing something wonderful.
Grace and peace, everyone. It's your boy, Pastor Kyron Shorter, and I'm so delighted that you chose to be with us today and worship along with us here in our broadcast. What an honor it is to be able to come to your homes, the comfort of your living rooms, your cars, wherever you may be, and bring this ministerial worship experience to you. We're excited about what God is doing here at Bethesda Temple because in this month, in this season, we're in revival. So hopefully you're ready to go with us as God restores us and revives us in our worship, our application of God's word, everything He wants to do in our homes and marriages and finances. Even in the midst of this pandemic, God is still bringing revival to His people. So you've come to the right place at the right time. I hope that you're in a comfortable place. Amen. Move that couch out the way, move that coffee table out the way, and come and worship with us. And let's go into the temple as we enjoy wonderful worship on this morning. God bless. We'll be right back.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Yes. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise God. I don't know about you, but I gotta give my God some praise. Yes. Because He's been good to me.
Hallelujah.
No matter what's going on in the world, I gotta give Him some praise. Come on and put your hands together like this.
Every mountain I will move. Every rough
testify and say,
praise me.
Come on and praise the Lord.
Praise me.
Oh, praise me.
Praise me.
Come on and give him praise.
Praise me.
Come on and magnify the Lord.
Praise me.
Lift me up.
Praise me.
Come on, praise me.
Praise me. Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Praise me.
Morning and God bless you all. Welcome to Bethesda Temple Church, Los Angeles, California. We're excited that you're here with us, wherever you may be worshiping all throughout the world. Literally, we're so honored that you would come and be a part of this worship experience with us. Let's go before the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you this day, a day like none other, oh God. We thank you for smiling upon us, for being in our midst. We ask, oh God, this day, oh God, that you would inhabit the praises of your people, oh God, that you would rest, oh God, rule and abide, oh God, in the hearts of your people as we make sanctuary, oh God, of the places we may be, oh God. We pray, oh God, that you would throw your weight around. Be strong, be high and lifted up, oh God. Be praised and glorified in every song that's uttered, every scripture that goes forth, oh God. Every dance, every praise, every hand clap unto you, oh God. Be thou exalted, oh God. Have free course, oh God, and save as you see fit. Deliver and free, oh God. We thank you for the power of the Holy Ghost, oh God, renewing and reviving, refreshing our minds even right now. Be high and lifted up. Be glorified. And we'll give you all the praise and all the glory this day in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Our scripture reading this morning can be found in the book of 2 Thessalonians chapter number 3, verses 1 through 5. Again, that's 2 Thessalonians chapter number 3, verses 1 through 5. Here beginning the reading of God's holy word. Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified, even as it is with you. And that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. For all men have not faith. But the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. And we have confidence in the Lord touching you, that ye both do and will do the things which we command you. And the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ. May God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing and doing of his word. We pray that you'll sit back, relax, and enjoy the rest of our service. Let's go forth and worship even now here at Bethesda Temple Church, Los Angeles. God bless you.
Come on and lift up your hands.
Yeah.
The song says, I need you. You need me. Because we're all a part of God's body. Wherever you are, if you're with somebody, if you're with your family member, I want you to look to them and say, I need you, and I need you to survive, especially during this time. We got so much things going on in the world, but the Bible says to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Turn to somebody and say, I need you to survive. Come on, choir. Sing, I need you.
I need you.
You need me.
You need me.
We're all a part.
We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with me.
Agree with me. Say, I need you.
I need you.
You need me.
You need me.
We're all a part.
We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with me.
Agree with me.
Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body.
It is His will.
It is His will.
That every need. You are important.
You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Come on, say it again. You are?
You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Let's sing that one more time so you can get the word. Say, I need you.
I need you.
You need me.
You need me.
We're all.
We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with me.
Agree.
Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body.
It is His will.
It is His will that every need be supplied.
You are important.
You are important to me.
I need you to survive. I want you to hug somebody and say that again.
You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Come on and say, I pray for you. You pray for me.
I pray for you.
You pray for me.
You pray
for me. Come on, I love you.
I love you. I need you to survive.
I won't harm you.
I won't harm you.
With words from my mouth.
With words. From my
sing,
mouth.
I love you.
I love
you. I need you to survive.
I need you to
sing. I pray for you.
I pray for
you'll
you.
You pray for me.
You pray.
Come on and say,
you.
I love you.
I love
I need
you. I need you to
I won't harm you.
I won't harm you.
With words.
With words from
sing,
my
sing, I love
mouth.
You.
I love you. I need you.
Come on, say it again. I pray
survive.
For you.
I pray.
You'll
for
pray
you.
For me.
You pray for
sing,
me.
Sing, I love you.
I love
I need you to survive.
I need you to
I won't survive. Harm you.
I won't harm
with words
you.
From my mouth.
With words from my
I
mouth.
I love you.
I love you. I need
come
you.
Come on, say it. I pray for you.
I pray for you. You pray for
I
me.
I love you.
I love you. I need you to
I won't harm you.
I won't
with words from my mouth.
With words from my mouth.
I love you.
I love you. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me.
Love you.
I love you.
I need you.
I need you to
I won't harm you.
I won't
with words from my mouth.
With words from my mouth.
I love you.
I love you.
I need you.
I need
come on.
You
I pray for you.
I pray for you.
You'll pray.
You'll pray for me.
I love you.
I love you. I need you to survive.
I won't harm you.
I won't harm you.
With words.
With words from my mouth.
I love you.
I love you. I need you
come on,
to
sing it. I
survive.
Pray for you.
I pray
you'll pray for,
you. For
me.
You pray. I love you.
I love you.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Show the Lord with gladness, come before his presence with singing. Know ye the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Come to his gates with thanksgiving, come to his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name.
For the Lord?
For the Lord, He is good. His mercy is everlasting. His truth endures to all generations.
Grace and peace, everybody. It's your boy, Pastor Kyron Shorter, with just a quick word, amen, concerning our giving today. We thank and praise God for those of you who have taken the faith challenge, even in this quarantine, to partner with us in giving. We certainly thank and praise God for those who have been giving via our various technological platforms, whether it be by Cash App or PayPal or just bring your offerings down by the office. We thank and praise God for everybody's liberality in this season when we know things are just tight, let's be honest. But I also thank and praise God for the testimony of so many of us who are receiving so many wonders of favor and the outpouring of God's favor upon the believer, as he says in his word, according to Malachi chapter 3 and verse number 10. And so I certainly hope today that you would take this faith journey with us, that you would give into the kingdom of God, that you would let God stretch you, that he may prove himself to be more than a provider in your life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness, your mercy, your compassion. We thank you, O God, for the tangible resources we have, O God. I certainly hope and pray that you would stimulate the heart of the believer. Stir us, O God, to, amen, give into your kingdom, even in such a time as this, O God. Let this seed that we sow, O God, become tangible manifestations as it relates, O God, to refinancing, to scholarships, to promotional advancement, O God, for doors, O God, for innovation and wisdom, O God, and the things that we desire to do as believers, O God. I pray a special blessing over every home, O God. Let provision, O God, and favor, O God, rest and rule and abide in each of the homes of your believers, O God. We take you at your word, and we trust, O God, that you do all things well, and little becomes much when we place it in your hands. We thank you for all these blessings. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you for partnering with us again. You can give by Cash App, PayPal. You can bring it on down there by the office at our corporate office, 4936 Crenshaw Boulevard. Meet God in his word and in scripture and have faith, amen, that God will do so much more in your life if you give. God bless you all and enjoy the rest of the services.
Praise the Lord, Bethesda family. These are your announcements for the week.
As we continue the Summer of Salvation Revival 2020, we're taking the next few weeks to explore a concept that has often been elusive to so many, particularly in the African American community, the concept of freedom. How difficult it is for one to fully understand and embrace the idea of freedom. Given all the renewed conversations and our headlines and acts of disobedience and protest and things that are happening right in front of our doors in our local communities, I thought it'd only be fitting that we have a conversation where we review the parallels of spiritual freedom and natural freedom. I certainly hope and pray over the next few weeks you'll join us and engage us as we have some honest conversations about the things that hinder us from fully being free. I certainly hope and pray that this summer, not only do we get full salvation, but we fully get a full concept of what freedom is. Join us as we continue the Summer of Salvation and as we explore this July, the struggle for freedom. A simple reminder that we're praying daily at 12 o'clock noon, Monday through Friday. Join us on the conference call line as we seek God for direction and healing and bring our petitions before Him in the noonday hour. We've been at it 12 weeks. Let's continue seeking God for direction in this particular season. Another reminder, Sunday School is marching on. Join us every Sunday morning from 9:30 to 10:30 as we explore God's Word through our anointed teaching staff. Invite a friend and join us every Sunday on the conference call line.
And I know that all things work together for my good. And I know that all things work together for my good.
Children's Church at 10 a.m. on Sundays. I'll see you there.
Tuesday evenings are Testimony Tuesday night. Join the saints as we lift up praise, songs of Zion, and testify the mighty works of God even in the COVID environment. All begins at 6 o'clock p.m. using the same access code. Additionally, join us for midweek Bible class, 7 o'clock p.m. over on Facebook. Join us as Word of God is explored, and you can also catch the re-airing on our YouTube page by simply searching We Are Bethesda. A friendly reminder that we're streaming every Sunday online over on Facebook at 11 o'clock a.m. Do us a favor and hit the share button. Leave a comment, leave a praise or word of encouragement. Join us weekly at 11 o'clock a.m. for online worship. And lastly, our food bank will be open on July 25th this month. If you know of anyone who is food insecure and has a need now, do not hesitate to call the church at area code 323-299-2591. We're making preparations to reopen the church, but until we do such and until it's safe, we ask that you join us and pray for us as we strategically seek God on the safest way possible for us all to unite in fellowship. God bless. Hey, what's up, everybody? It's your boy, Pastor Kyron Shorter. Hey, it's been a minute since we've seen you all. We've forgotten how some of you look. So do us a favor and send us a picture. We want to see your beards. We want to see your gray hairs, all those things. Send us an updated family photo. We're putting something together, amen, just to kind of capitalize our experiences in quarantine as a church family. So send us a flick. Send it over to our church email address, which is btc4909@att.net. Again, that's btc4909@att.net. It's on the screen, so just send an email and send us a picture. We'd love to see how you're doing, and we want to see how your families are growing and how God is favoring you in the midst of the quarantine season. God bless you. We've got some great things on the horizon, so stay tuned. God bless.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah. God is doing something wonderful. It's time for us to grieve. Something beautiful, something marvelous, and God's gonna get the glory out of every situation. Come on, put your hands on it. You should know it by now. Everybody, help me declare.
God is doing something wonderful in me. God is doing something wonderful. Something awesome and incredible. Only He will get the glory.
Father, we thank you for your loving kindness, your grace, your compassion. We ask that you would speak now your eternal words of life, O God. Minister to the portals of our being, O God. Speak, O God, to our future, O God. Speak to our current situation, O God. We ask, O God, that you would illuminate. Oh, God, that you would give us a yearning to go further and to press beyond what we see. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. The word of the Lord can be found today in the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 12. I'd ask that you move with me quickly. 1 Kings, chapter number 12, verses number 26 through 30. 1 Kings, chapter number 12, verse 26 through 30. Here beginning the reading of God's holy word. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David, if this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem. Then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even until Rehoboam, king of Judah. And they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, is it too much for you to go up to Jerusalem? Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of Egypt. And he set one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan. And this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan. Father, illuminate and reveal all things by the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We're continuing our series of messages concerning the struggle for freedom. Today, I'd like to go a little bit further and minister from this subject, the monuments must come down. The monuments must come down. If you've been following with us the last few weeks in this study concerning the struggle for freedom, we started in the book of Mark, chapter number 9, the message entitled Finding Freedom. We met a man who wanted his son to be spiritually free. And he unlocked one of the first principles concerning the struggle for freedom, or principles concerning freedom that we've been embarking upon and studying. And it's that freedom can only be found in God, and that freedom can only be sustained by a dependence on Jesus. We studied this the 4th of July weekend, and we, you know, found correlations in how the United States had found independence from Britain, but how the believer, in order for the believer to remain, amen, free, we rely on our dependence and the ability of God by being dependent on God. The second lesson we found was in the book of Mark, chapter number 9, going back a little bit further and diving a little bit more into that particular text. It was entitled Unlocking Freedom, and it's dealt with the yearning of the disciples who had a desire to want to know why they were unsuccessful in casting out the demons in the lives of the son that was possessed. The scriptures tell us that there are a couple things that, amen, come to mind or paramount to us, and that is this. It's that freedom, amen, comes when we won in the debate. We stop debating about what it is that we desire for God to do in our lives. Amen. And then most importantly, amen, Jesus, amen, answers the question that we must be willing to ask if freedom is unavailable to us. And that's why freedom is not working. Jesus would respond to his disciples and tell them that there are some things that only come out but by prayer and by fasting. That freedom comes when we learn to focus, when we learn to communicate, and most importantly, to starve out the vices and strongholds and the demonic forces that feed off of our attention. Subjecting the flesh to the will of God will drive out the obstacles of oppression that hinder our freedom. Today, our study goes a little bit further into the concept of freedom, and I would like to explore for just a few moments this afternoon the conflict within, or the civil war within, the struggle that is within. The Bible tells us throughout many courses of Scripture, the Scriptures would tell us that, amen, struggle for freedom sometimes requires us to have internal warfare. Galatians chapter number 5 and verse number 17 would tell us, for the flesh lusteth after the Spirit, and the spirit after the flesh, they are contrary the one to the other, so that they cannot do what ye would.
the Apostle Paul would go a little bit further with us and tell us that there exists a law, that there is a law of struggle, amen, that the believer often has to deal with and put up with as we try to live a spirit-filled life, but we're stuck in this flesh. The Apostle Paul would go on to tell us that there's a struggle between my spirit man that's in constant conflict with my flesh, all housed in the same manner, but in conflict to gain control and to gain perspective. Romans 7 is another, amen, a depiction of this internal warfare. Amen. The Apostle Paul would tell us that I find a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity, taking away my freedom, amen, by bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death, this torture, this destruction? I thank God, amen, through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I serve the law of God, but with the flesh, I serve the law of sin. This internal conflict is something that Paul would tell us would be something that we all would have to, amen, deal with anytime you're aspiring to do something great for God, amen, but not just something great for God. Anybody filled with the Holy Ghost is going to have to deal with some manner of struggle, the consistent conflict that perpetuates to a place where we have a war against, amen, our internal members just to stay in the will of God. And I have to oppose the natures that conflict God's will and oppose the nature, amen, that is set apart to lead me to destruction. I have to fight with all vigor, amen, a nature that wants to bring me into captivity and make me a slave to sin. The Apostle Paul would tell the church at Corinth in the 9th chapter of 1 Corinthians that this is an opposing force that comes to hinder us from the prize of salvation. We are running with purpose. We're running with a destination, amen. Running to meet Jesus, amen, to put on incorruption. And the conflict that we have with the flesh, it causes us to keep our bodies under subjection. If you want to be free, you're going to have to learn to keep your body under subjection, to preserve your body from infection or from contamination. And because we're in this flesh and because this flesh is not going anywhere, the Apostle Paul tells us we have to transition. We have to transition from being sprinters to now being boxers. Yes, because if we don't combat the evil of the flesh, we'll become a prisoner to it. So you have this perpetual conflict on the inside, the spirit man that wants to win, and a carnal nature that wants to sabotage victory. You have a nature that wants to do God's will and the flesh which wants to make you a castaway. And when you have two forces or entities within a house and a structure, amen, that cannot agree, cannot come to agreement, you have conflict, amen, that leads, amen, to the principle of subjection, amen, that often leads to war or warfare. The word subjection, to be subjected, or the word subjection, is a word that is polarizing. In the Greek, it means submission. It means alliance. It means confusion, subservience, or it means resignation or compliance. However, if it's not carried out, it'll lead to rebellion or confusion or misalignment or unconformity, divorce, and or even war. Subjection is a beautiful thing. To bring it to a place of subjection is to be brought to a place of peace. But anytime that peace is interrupted, you have war. Because the opposite, amen, of war is peace, and the opposite of peace is war. This is exactly what was carried out in our country in 1981, or I'm sorry, and actually in 1881, 1861 through 1865 right here in America. You had two forces with two different ideas that occupied the same space. this is what led to what was known as the Civil War here in America. Undoubtedly, one of the most ugly stains that are placed upon the history of this country was the internal conflict or the internal fighting. The only battle in which America unequivocally lost is this thing we call the Civil War. Now, there's a common explanation for it. There are some people who say that the Civil War was fought over the moral issue of slavery. If you go a little bit deeper, you'll come to understand that it was the economics associated with slavery and the power of control, amen, that was the contention from the Confederates or those in the South. One of the key issues that they often talk about now are state rights, the rights for a state to operate independently. In spiritual terms, it's the right for, amen, a member to operate outside of the collective purpose of the body. No different from the kidney or the brain wanting to do something different or to operate outside of the wheelhouse or fashion or purpose or structure of the body. But notice the dirty little secret about this thing we call the Civil War. More than it was about states' rights and more than it was about slavery or racism and more than it was about the color of anyone's particular skin, the only color of great significance that led to this conflict was the color green. because all warfare sometimes is synonymous with power and money. If you are even paying attention to what's going on in our country now, you'll come to realize that the fighting that we're seeing is a fight, amen, because, amen, of the racial divisions, but not only because of racial divisions, because of the principalities associated with power and money. And so this is the resistance to freedom. The resistance to freedom, amen, is to cut off access, amen, to keep one class of people more empowered from the other through money. Many of us sometimes miss the long game about racism because we see the color of our skin and we see oppression. But I come to tell somebody that if you're paying attention to it, the new Jim Crows, the new racial divides, the new discriminations, or the new oppressions are economic. Yes. Power becomes the motivation. How do we maintain policies and power structures to oppress the people, but also how do we keep economics intact? The wealth, amen, now becomes a picture of the haves and the have-nots. The deciding factors now that drive everything are power and money. You see class separations. This is why, amen, you see so many people disenfranchised now. They're not disenfranchised because of chains and whips, and we can have a conversation about the lasting impacts of slavery and Jim Crow, but the goal now is through economics to oppress a people. That's why there's so much opposition to fair hiring practices. That's why there's so much opposition to fair lending practices. That's why you see so much opposition to funding urban communities and oppositions from the government, right, to fund programming to help people up, right? You won't see too much support in these endeavors. Why? For fear of wealth redistribution and an equal playing field for all. That's why there's so much fighting about health care and education, because the fight for freedom becomes now about policy, and policy is shaped by who has power. And so your flesh, your strong man wants power, the power to sin. But the wages, the commerce, the economy, and the economies of scale of sin is death. And so the Civil War broke out in our country because, amen, we had certain members, amen, who wanted certain things and other members who didn't want other things. And so you had the North against the South. You had the fighting, amen, of what they call the Union versus the Confederates. And we know the story, and we know that at the end of the day, The North was victorious, but we sometimes don't tell you why they were victorious. They were victorious in warfare because of their manufacturing capabilities. Yes, those down in the South never had the psychological ingenuity to work smarter instead of working harder. They relied so much upon indentured servants. It required so much manual support that it crippled their ability to tap into things, amen, from an infrastructure perspective that could help them manufacture the weaponry necessary to go forth in conflict. Now, I just want to pause for a moment to tell some of you, yes, that you're going to lose the war every time when you don't apply yourself to think smarter instead of having to work harder. If there's one thing, amen, that will always keep you oppressed, always keep you from having freedom, it's by being so stuck in the way you're doing things that you don't ask God for innovation and creativity. I even pray now in the name of Jesus that God would open up a wind of creativity and innovation in the lives of people. The North was able to capitalize upon manufacturing capabilities to start manufacturing weaponry, the weaponry necessary to defeat the enemy. The next thing, of course, that took place that kind of, amen, corresponds with that is economics. Economics. The North had more economics. The North had more resources. The North had an accumulation of the wealth of the United States because most of the banks were up in the North. Yes, and so when you have access to more resources, it makes you more advantageous in how you can go about accomplishing victory. I come to tell some of you, you're disenfranchised because you refuse to tap into the power you already have. You're disenfranchised because you fail to realize that your father owns a cattle of 1,000 hills. You fail to realize that your God has all power in his hand and there is no matter of wealth that escapes him. But it all depends upon where you are aligned. Yes, the South lost because of naval strength. That wealth and those weaponries helped them, amen, overcome the South and the lack of ingenuity. They lost because of ground transportation and then most importantly because of population. There were more in the North than there were in the South. Some of us are defeated because we fail to take the word of God at heart when he says that there are more against us than are more with us than are against us. Yes, no, you must realize the fleet of heaven that is behind you, rooting for your victory, rooting for you to come forth victorious. And then, most importantly, the reason why the South lost, even more so than the North won, is because of the politics associated in victory. You had competing strategies in the South. People who wanted victory to come about one way. Yes, and when you have too many people in your ear, but never the ear or pulse of God, it leaves you to a place where you're broken, disenfranchised, with no strategy for victory. Yes, the South had too many people with too many different polarizing views of how the victory would be won. And although they won at Fort Sumter, and although they had some victories along the way, and although the deadliest battle was in Gettysburg, they still ended up having to surrender because they did not understand that it took more than the idea to be free. It took resources to be free. Yes, and those resources we have in Christ Jesus. Yes, so as we take a look at some of the lessons learned from those period of times, we come to realize that internal conflict is something that we've seen in our country, something that we deal with on the daily. Every day, you have to stop competing forces, the politics of the mind that try to convince you that there's another strategy better than God. Yes, you have to compete against the internal voices that won't let you pursue your dreams and expand your capabilities in order to be competitive and to fight the good fight of faith. faith. And so we're learning some lessons even 150 years later. Yes, black eyes all across the spectrum. An ugly day and dark days in this country, but some things that were learned. Yes, and even in the midst of that, we find people getting light from those images. People who are still paying reverence to flags of a defeated foe. Even right now outside, we're in countries that are in states down south, we're having conversations about taking down monuments about people who led us astray, who led us the wrong way. All across this country, we're in an uproar about monuments as well as city street names and townships and schools that bear the name of individuals who are the most vile and racist individuals that this country has ever seen. We still have people who are endured to a legacy of people who committed treason and turned their back on this country. Yes, and if these so-called heroes are allowed to stay up, the message that we're sending is that you can oppose, amen, the force and direction of the vision of this country and still get a pat on your back. Yes, people are literally so attached to monuments that these monuments that symbolize the worst in us. But if you follow exactly what I'm saying and venture into the scriptures, you'll come to tell us, or you'll come to see through the scriptures that come to tell us, this was not something that was not a plague of the people of God in scripture. Our text today is found in the midst of internal conflict. The children of Israel who are competing. The children of Israel who are now set in division, fighting against each other. It's an internal split within the children of Israel, prophesied to David after, amen, his affair with Bathsheba. Yes, but even more so than the sin of King David, the splitting of Israel was directly related the result of the doings of King Solomon, his son. The scriptures would tell us that Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord. He went not fully after the Lord as his father did. Solomon loved strange women, women of nations that the Lord said would undo the children of Israel. The Lord would tell them, he would say, ye shall not go in to them, neither shall thou come into you. He would say, for surely they will turn you away, amen, after the hearts of their gods. Solomon claved unto these in love, had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, all of which the wives turned away his heart from God. Solomon's wives turned his heart away, amen, to pursue of their gods. His heart was not perfect unto the Lord as his father David was. Solomon went after Asherah, the goddess of the Zidonians, and then he went after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. Then did Solomon, he built a high place in Shemesh, the abomination of Moab. If you study that word Shemesh, it means destroyer, absurd, or subduer, or the fish god. Yes, he built it right in front of Israel, the city of peace. What sense does that make? To erect a monument of a destroyer right in the presence, or right in front of the city of peace. Yes, he also built something from Molech. Yes, which means king. So he raises up a monument of a destroyer and another king to have worship be given unto someone who was not Jehovah God, who we know to be the true king. And the scripture says that the Lord was angry with Solomon. The Bible said God would tell Solomon, because you did not keep my covenant and my statutes. He says, I will render or I will tear the kingdom from thee, and I will give it to thy servant. Not because of David, but because of you, Solomon. He says, except I will not rend all of the kingdom. He says, I'm going to leave one of the tribes to your son for David, my servant's sake. God would raise up a man by the name of Jeroboam, a man of mighty valor. Solomon would see him as a young man who was industrious. Solomon would see him rule over all of the charge of the house of Joseph. The scripture tells us that the prophet by the name of Ahijah would come to him somewhere around 1 Kings 11:29 and through 31 to tell him all that God desired to do in the life of Jeroboam. Yes, the scripture says that he catches Jeroboam coming out of the gate of Jerusalem, and he begins to take his new garment, and he rent it into 12 pieces. And he said unto Jeroboam, he says, take these 10 pieces, for thus saith the Lord, God of Israel, behold, I will rend the kingdom out of the hand of Solomon, and will give thee 10 tribes. And then the prophet Ahijah tells Jeroboam all that God had told Solomon. He told Solomon, because you didn't keep my statutes, because you, amen, let the wives that you fell in love with turn your heart away from me, I'm going to snatch the kingdom away from you. Yes. And but the prophet would tell Jeroboam this. He says, it shall be if thou wilt hearken unto all that I have commanded thee, and walk in my ways, and do right in my sight, to keep my statutes and my commandments as David thy servant did. He says, and I will be with thee, and will build thee a sure house, as I built for David, and will give Israel unto thee. This was the same charge that was given to Solomon. Walk upright and I'll be with you. It's given to Jeroboam. The scriptures tell us that somehow Solomon finds out that Jeroboam is to take a man the kingdom, or piece of his kingdom. And the scriptures say that Solomon put out a hit to have Jeroboam die. And Jeroboam flees for his life, and he runs to a place called Egypt to hide. Isn't it interesting that after God had given him a revelation, after God had spoken to his destiny and had told him the great things that were to come, isn't it interesting that of all the places he would run to Egypt, which is a type of sin. With the word God has given you, with the favor that God desires to show you, I have a question to ask this house. Of all the places that you can run, why would you run back to Egypt? Why would you run back to sin? After all that God has told you, you shall be. After God has spoken and told you what you can be, why would you take that word and compromise yourself and go find refuge in sin? Yes, some of you are so afraid of falling to your enemies that you would rather run to the nestles of sin than to take God at his word and stand on it. Jeroboam had a promise from God, but got so fearful that it lost him to go to a place of sin. Yes. And this brings us to chapter number 12 as I get out of here. Yes, because God is a promise keeper. And because God is a promise keeper, he does exactly what he says. He raises up Solomon's son, Rehoboam, to take part of the tribes. The scripture says that Rehoboam shows up his first day on the duty, and he has the people come before him. And people come before him and they tell him, we will follow after you so long as you are good to us, as long as you don't abuse us, as long as you lift some of the weights off of us, we'll comply with you and we'll do exactly. If you ease some of the yoke, you'll have no greater faithful people to you. The Bible says that Rehoboam leaves the presence of these people to go caucus for 3 days. He asks the elders of the community, what shall I say to these people? What shall I do? In other words, the elders say, if you come out basically like you got some sense and you're nice to the people, the people will fall in line with you. Rehoboam goes and he asks now some younger men. He says, what shall I do? The younger people prophesied to him and they said, you should flex. Yes, you should be 10 times harder. 10 times harder than your father was on these people. And Rehoboam, instead of taking the words of the older folk, because you know we don't like to listen to nobody over a certain age. We think we know it all. The scriptures say that Jeroboam went out before these people and he tells these people, if you thought my dad was a nut, if you thought my dad had it bad on you, yes, these yokes that are going to be on you, these whips that are going to be on you, these things that are going to be on you, these chastened whips on you, they're going to chase you like scorpions. Yes, Jeroboam had snuck back into the picture from Egypt to hear what was going on. The Bible says that when the people heard what Rehoboam had to say to the people, the Bible says that the people tell Rehoboam, forget you and your papa. Yes, I'm giving you the South Central version. Yes, forget the house of David. Why would we serve under anybody such rude has no care for us, that has no desire to see us empowered? The Bible tells us, yes, that Rehoboam had sent one of his servants out to try to get tribute. Yes, but amen, those that were of the house of Israel, they stoned him with stones. Yes, and Rehoboam, he made haste getting on his chariot to get to Jerusalem. And the house of Israel and now the house of Judah are divided, with Judah making their way down to Jerusalem and the house of Israel looking to appoint someone. Yes, this is when Jeroboam's face comes back up and the people say, Jeroboam is going to be our leader. He's going to be our king. So Jeroboam now has on the house of Israel and Rehoboam has the house of Judah. The scriptures say that Rehoboam wants his daddy's house back. He wants a united kingdom. Yes, and he gathers himself some 140 men to go and do battle. But then the word of the Lord comes unto him and tells him, yes, that he is going to only have the legacy of King Solomon and the remnant of the people of the house of Judah and Benjamin. And he says, you shall not go up and fight against the children of Israel, but every man should return to their house. The Bible says that Jeroboam starts settling in. He starts building infrastructure. He starts building the cities. He starts going about his plan to be a king. However, because he retreated to Egypt, all he knows now is sin. The Bible says that Jeroboam, yes, he concocts within his heart to conspire to believe that if these people have to go down to Jerusalem every year to sacrifice and to worship, they'll grow a heart for Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, the son of David, and somehow they'll abandon me. And an abandoned mean they'll kill me. And if they kill me, then my administration will be for naught. The Bible says, yes, that Jeroboam, he got so insecure about the prophecy that was given to him that he does something within his heart, and that's contaminate worship. The Bible says that he starts building monuments. The Bible says that he built a monument of gold, two golden calves. He places one of them in Bethel, and he places the other in Dan. And he says to the people, is it too much for you to go up to Jerusalem? So convincing with his words, that he convinced the nation that worship was no longer relevant. He convinced the nation that it was too far a journey to get to the house of God to make alms and sacrifice. He had convinced the people that it was okay if they took a shortcut on worship and bowed to the golden calves. Yes, we have to be very careful of the idols in our lives, people of God, that make us a slave and a prisoner to condemnation and bondage. Yes, the spirit of the day that tells you, is it too much for you to get on the prayer call every day at noon? It's too much. The preacher is asking too much of you to give offering and to pay tithes. The preacher is asking too much of you to love your neighbor as God says in his word. It's too much of you to sacrifice to make the journey to go to Jerusalem to give God what he's worthy of. And as a result of it, the house of Israel fell to idols. They fell to monuments. They failed because it was too hard to get back to the place of worship. And I come to tell some of you in this house that the reason why you're chained and the reason why you're still locked up in bondage and the thing that's keeping you spiritually oppressed is your inability to see that the journey is not too great and the will of God is not too hard. We have made ourselves so comfortable with the spirit of convenience that we bow to idols and we have replaced the things of God. We have replaced God's commandments and God's precepts with temporary convenience. Yes, we have convinced ourselves that it's too much to worship. It's too much to be faithful to Bible class. It's too much. They're asking for too much. And there is an enemy that is calculating your laziness, your inability to think that the presence of God is worth it enough for you to get up and to press. Let's get out of here, Aaron. The Bible says he calculated that these people were too carnal not to see that they were falling victim to the monument of the day. He made a calculated risk that I could convince these people that what they're substituting for worship is good enough. And I come to tell some of you that the reason why we're still in bondages of yoke, why we're still oppressed, why we haven't been free, is because we've given up our pursuit of the presence of God, and we've replaced it with convenience. We've convinced ourselves that we're okay the way we are. We've convinced ourselves that we no longer need to do it God's way. That way is old-fashioned. That way is how my grandmother and them did it. And so we have convinced ourselves that we'll bow to convenience. We'll bow out to the calves. And I believe that God sent me here to tell you that it's time for you to let go of the monuments that did nothing to build up your freedom. You remember the golden calves back in Exodus. When the preacher had the people dancing around the golden calves as Moses came down after meeting with God to see the people delighting in idolatry and delighting in the temporary conveniences of something God did not sanction. And I come to tell you that God sent me here to encourage this house that there were some monuments in Egypt that signify scars of warfare that you do not want to be entangled in again. But I hear God saying these monuments must come down. You've got to convince yourself with all your heart that God's presence is worth me getting up to meet him in prayer. God's presence is significant enough for me to open my Bible. God's presence means so much to me. I'll lay aside the weights of sin. God's glory means so much to me that I'll press beyond my own limitations. I come to tell some of you that the monuments stand in the way of the glory of God. That these golden calves, they are obstructs to God's glory. They're barriers to freedom. They symbolize things of the past. They symbolize things that God has brought you out of. They symbolize things that God has delivered you from. And God is saying, don't you make these things idols in your life. Don't you bow down to these calves. Don't you bow down to the narrative of the day. Don't you suspend my glory for a temporary convenience. Jeroboam had convinced them to bow down to golden calves in a place called Dan. I went and I studied where Dan was in proximity to Jerusalem and came to figure out that Dan was only 129 miles from the temple in Jerusalem. What are you saying? The enemy lied to him. The enemy had convinced them that it was too far to get to God's house when it was closer than they could have imagined. I come to tell you that freedom is closer than you can imagine. 129 miles is all they needed to get to a place of refreshing, to get to a place of revival. I come to tell this house, the monuments must come down. You're too close to God's favor. You're too close to healing. You're too close to grace. You're too close to favor. You're too close to healing. You're too close to revival. You're too close to the mercies of God. To stop where you are, it's not too much for you to journey a little bit further. It's not too much for you to hang in there a little bit longer. It's not too much to give him glory. It's not too much to press your way to the city of peace. Somebody help me praise his wonderful name. Say yeah. Bethel. Bethel was a place that was almost 5,000 miles away. But many of them that stopped in Dan were cheating themselves of peace with God and favor with God. I come to tell some of you, the monuments have to come down, because as long as it's standing there, it blocks your view of glory. It blocks your view of the tabernacle. It blocks your view of freedom. As long as those monuments stay up in Mississippi, I'm reminded that I was a slave to the past. As long as the high schools are named after people that repressed me, I'm a slave of the past. But I hear God telling this house, you're too close to freedom to stop here. You're too close to destiny to stop here. Press on, church. Drive on, church. Pray on, church. Press on, church. Praise on, church. Worship on, church. Consecrate yourself. It's not too far. Press your way to greatness. Press your way to new heights. Press your way to His glory. Press your way into abundance. Press your way into freedom. Somebody shout, the monuments must come down. Everything that exalts His name, everything that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God, even right now, these monuments in my mind that tell me I can't lift my voice, these monuments in my mind that tell me I can't wave my hand, these monuments in my mind that tell me there's a better way than God's way. The devil is a liar. Somebody help me tear it down. The stronghold, vain imagination, principalities, yokes of bondage, and discouragement. God's will is what I want. God's way is what I want. Somebody help me. Give Him glory. You're too close. Dan is too close to Jerusalem for you to settle for a substitute. The monuments must come down. The temporary gratifications, the things that are reprehensible to God, must come down. The things that offend God must come down. Some of us need to get delivered from convenience. I don't feel like worshiping today. I don't feel like being obedient today. And the Lord is saying, as long as you keep feeling how you're feeling, and as long as you keep settling for substitutes, you will stay locked up in prison. The struggle for freedom, this internal conflict, is a fight to remember how valuable God's presence is, how valuable the wonder of His glory is. Don't you let the enemy convince you that you can worship a substitute. Don't you let the enemy convince you that you're okay the way you are. Jeroboam set up these things strategically to keep power, but in doing so, he alienated a country. He alienated a people from true worship and intimacy with their God. I hear God saying that for many of us, we're relishing the temporary conveniences, and the temporary conveniences are the things that are keeping us oppressed. Our inability to get up and to go a little bit further in God. You were too close to Jerusalem to stop in Dan. The monuments are blocking your view of freedom, and so they must come down. the monuments are blocking your view of a life unshackled. Do you remember Egypt? Do you remember what it was to be whipped and abused, and what it was to be worked like a slave? Do you remember what that was? Why would you go back to that? Why would you think the images of Egypt, the images of bondage and wilderness, are acceptable for you? You cannot get a view of freedom as long as these monuments stay in the way. Many of us don't even realize that we've created idols out of things, and they have us so out of focus, so out of perspective, that it's hindering our ability to see the glory of God. God is saying today, in your struggle for freedom, you've got to tear down those images that remind you that you're three-fifths of a person. Those images that tell you that you're inadequate in God. Those images that tell you that you're a stranger unto God. Those images that remind you that you're less than. God is saying those monuments must come down. And it's a good day. It's a good day to say that it's time for somebody to be arrested for the death of Breonna Taylor. You're here today. You desire salvation. You're here today and you want the idols of your heart to come down. God is saying, make a decision. Let this word sober you. Let this word sober you. Let this word convict you. Let this word penetrate to those places. Let it come right now. Let it be an opportunity for you to come into alignment with God's plan. For you to stop chasing things that look like the promise, that really are designed to keep you repressed. Those things that they look like they're almost the promise, but they aren't the promise. God said they must come down. The images in your mind must come down. These things that we have made idols must come down. These monuments must come down so that you can truly be free in Jesus' name. These things, yeah, these idols, these things that they get more of your attention than God does. I'm on my phone more than I'm in prayer. I'm more engaged in gossip than I am engaged in what the Spirit is saying to the church. God is saying these idols must come down. Anything that's competing for God's attention, anything that's competing for relevance, according to trying to be in direct competition with the relevance of my God, they must come down. God is saying this day, your struggle for freedom begins with your ability to tear the monuments down, tear them down. Forgetting those things which are behind me. Forgetting Egypt, forgetting those symbols. We're not going backwards. We're not going to allow the temporary convenience to hinder us from pursuing God's presence and God's glory. You are too close to Jerusalem to stop in Dan. Too close to the promise to get stuck in Dan. Too close to the coming of our King to settle for a substitute. Too close to his reappearing for us to be stuck in bondage and condemnation. This is your day. You can be free. All to Jesus, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Father, right now, oh God, we ask that the yokes be broken, that the strong man come down in the name of Jesus, that the monuments, that the things that take up occupancy in our mind, that they would come down in the name of Jesus. Every high imagination, everything that exalts itself against you, everything that pulls us from you, everything that makes us enemy of you, in the name of Jesus, we ask right now that you have those strongholds come down in Jesus' name. We believe you for the promise. We're too close to your presence to let similes or to let, amen, things that are fickles of our imagination hinder us from the promise. Give us our mind back in the name of Jesus. We declare mental freedom right now in the name of Jesus, that the strongholds of repression in the mind would come down in the name of Jesus. Set your people free. Free indeed. free in the mind. The idols of our heart, let them be stripped in the name of Jesus. Let you be the focus of our worship and the focus of our attention. It's not too hard for us. It's not too hard for us to celebrate you. It's not too hard for us to journey a little bit further to see what the end is going to be. Father, we put our confidence, our trust in you, because you have yet to fail us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. If you don't know the Lord Jesus and a part of your sin, we encourage you today to come to know him. You can receive water baptism in Jesus' name by the infilling of the Holy Ghost. You can join us today in freedom. You don't have to live another day in bondage. He whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Let those monuments come down and embrace freedom in Jesus' name. All to thee I freely give. I will ever love and trust him and him daily. Will you heal?
Surrender all. I surrender.